is greater far, the tongue open can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty bear bowed down with care. God gave his son.
To sing together from our hymn book, hymn number 11, O Worship the King. I think we've had a great start from these wonderful young people. May the Lord bless them.
Amen.
They are mainly drawn from our churches and groups in the Midlands of England as well as Northwest. And I can say that we also have our young people that have teamed up with them from Germany and Republic of Ireland. We really appreciate all that they have done for us this morning, both in the orchestration as well as giving us a wonderful rendition on the wonders of the cross. And then Sister Shamba gave us the last one on the solo, The Love of God. It's our turn to sing together, to blend our voices. Let's take 1, 4, and 6. Verses 1, 4, and 6 of hymn number 11. And we have Brother Moyowa as our song leader this morning.
accept our thanks and praise this morning.
Glorify your name.
be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. The last verse we shall render standing without any instrumentation, after which we shall be led in prayer.
As we remain standing with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, we call on Brother John from Paris branch to come forward and lead us in prayer.
Seigneur Jésus, merci pour ton amour. Merci Jésus. Oui, c'est par amour que tu nous as créés dans ce monde. Et par amour, tu es en train de nous garder jusqu'à ce jour. Et par amour encore, tu nous as réunis ici pour nous bénir. Seigneur, merci. Nous sommes déjà là. Et tu as dit que l'homme ne vit pas que du pain, mais aussi de ta parole. Seigneur, tu as nourri notre corps. Maintenant, viens nourrir notre âme. Jésus, donne-nous notre pain quotidien de notre âme. Donne-nous le pain quotidien de notre âme. Ce matin, à travers ta parole, sauve, sanctifie, baptise, guéris, exauce, fais tout pour ta gloire. Nous avons prié au nom puissant de Jésus. Amen.
Okay, we continue with the service by turning to our hymn book, chorus number 64.
There is power, there is power, there is power in the blood of Jesus. There is healing, there is healing, there is blood of Jesus. There's forgiveness in the blood of Jesus. There's salvation, there's salvation in the blood of Jesus. There's forgiveness.
This morning, I want to thank the Lord God. I was a sinner. I came to the Lord. He saved my soul. I pressed for what? He sanctified me and baptized me with the Holy Ghost. There came a point in my life when the devil wanted me to sway, but I blessed the living God, the mighty God of heaven and earth. He brought me back. He set my feet on the path of righteousness. I bless the name of the Lord. Oh, I don't know where to start from. The Lord has done a mighty thing in my life. When we're about to start coming for this camp meeting, the morning we're supposed to wake up at 3 a.m. and start our journey, my son was just, he wasn't well at all, but I praise the Lord God. God laid his hand on him, and we're here today. Oh, not only that, there is protection in the blood of Jesus. I've often had testimony. People will testify, oh, they forgot to turn up their cooker. They forgot to do this, but the Lord God Almighty protected them. Mine is not about a cooker. Do you know, last December during the snow time, we parked our car on the road on a slope. And the most mistake that we made, we forgot to do the handbrake. The handbrake was not on. My husband parked the car, came into the house, the car started to roll. The car started rolling. But I bless the Almighty Father, the God who rules heaven and earth, the God who is to be praised from the rising of the sun to the setting down. Oh, I bless the name of the Lord. Do you know the angel of the Lord was watching over that vehicle? The vehicle was moving. The vehicle was supposed to roll into another car, into another vehicle. But the angel of the Lord turned the car. It did not hit the car in front. Oh, not only that, the car was moving again, was about to hit the lamppost, but the God of heaven had turned the car. The car was moving again, was supposed to roll into a building. Oh, the Almighty said, it's enough. Now you have to stop. The Almighty Father stopped the car. I thank God for protection. Not only that, that same day, we were invited for a very special event in London. We got there that same day in the evening. My husband took the boy out. On their way back, oh, I bless the name of the Lord. God is mighty.
I want to thank God this morning, for he is good and his mercies endure forever. I want to thank God for bringing me back from the world of sin. He saved my soul, sanctified and baptized me with his spirit. I want to testify to the power of God. Late last month, I told one of my boss at work that I want an increase in my contract hour. I was having 60 hours contract. And then all of us, majority of us, I met some people there that have been there 2 years, 3 years. All of us were still having a 60 hours contract. And I'm just 10 months there. But I told my boss, please, I want an increase to 100 because I need to apply for an apartment from the common. And then my boss said, there's no problem. For to my greatest surprise, I requested for 100 hours, but I was given 120. This is what God can do. I thank God for my family. God gave me a good husband and a fearing man. I thank God concerning my daughter too. We thank God. There are a lot of challenges on this way, but God has been there. He has been our keeper. He has been there in everything. Pray, children of God, please pray for me. I want to serve this God to the end. Thank you.
Glory be to God. I want to thank God for this gospel. He made me what I am. Salvation is good. God brought me when I was very small to this gospel, and he saved my soul. Sanctified me, he baptized me, and he kept me. God is good. The way God works for me since he called me, I cannot express it. I cannot even tell somebody, because in my house, I was like Joseph. But here I am. Glory be to God. God has done so many things. He gave me a man of my heart, my husband. He gave me children. In my family, my biological family, we are very few. But see, all these people, the way they are caring for me. Blessing, have you eaten? Blessing, I came here. I didn't plan to be here. But how God made it, I say, may his name be praised. May he use heaven to reward us. Because some people are very useful. They are very helpful with some people. I was just on my own, come for visit where I normally come. Are you going for camp meeting? I say, I didn't plan. God, just get ready. Join us to the camp meeting. And the whole place is like I'm in heaven. May God help me to see heaven. I enjoy everything. I say, may God bless all of us in Jesus' name.
thank God this morning for the fine blood of Jesus.
Amen.
You know, I have the privilege to be born into this glorious gospel. You know, when we're growing up, our parents taught us in the way of the Lord. You know, I thank God that God put the love of the gospel in my heart.
Amen.
You know, when at some point I prayed, God saved my soul.
Amen.
You know, he sanctified me.
Amen.
And he baptized me with the Holy Ghost and fire.
Amen.
You know, and I continue this journey. You know, at a point, the devil determined that, you know, it would be an history that I used to come to this church.
Hmm.
But I thank the Lord that God helped me to make a decision that
yes.
come what may, I will stand with the Lord.
Amen.
And you know, that Lord has never failed me.
Amen.
There are many things I thought that, okay, maybe I'll be able to do, I will not be able to do. You know, I thank the Lord in my academy, God helped me
Amen.
To achieve the highest degree I can achieve. You know, God provided a wife for me. He gave me children. You know, he provided a job for me even in this country. You know, everything I've prayed about, I think about it, there's nothing God has not done. You know, and he keep the love of God in my heart. You know, this same God, he can protect.
Yeah.
Just last Thursday, I was taking Theo to school and Gabriel decided to join us. We were driving all of a sudden. I didn't know what happened. One car was just coming head on. I couldn't press the brake. Bang. We just had an accident. The car was really very, very damaged. Then I was thinking about it. Even if I saw the car coming, I could have applied the brake, but I couldn't do anything. But by the grace of God, you know, we came out of the car alive.
Yeah.
You know, if you see Gabriel running all around, that is victory on his own.
Yeah.
You know, God protected us. He brought us to this camp meeting. He's been blessing us. I give glory to the name of the Lord. You know, this God that has helped me thus far, I believe that he will help me to the end. Praise the Lord with me.
Thank God that he saved my soul, he sanctified me, and he baptized me with his precious Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Today I want to thank God for the power of protecting.
Uh-huh.
On January the 16th, I was on my way to school, but unfortunately I did not reach school that day because on our way we had a horrible accident. Our school bus crashed into a house wall. It was so bad, and everybody was shouting, and I was in that bus, and I didn't know if I would survive. And I prayed, I shouted, Jesus,
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
And I don't know how God did it, but he saved me.
Amen.
He brought me out of that bus. It was a really miracle because
yeah.
the bus was full and everybody was injured.
Mm-hmm.
But I thank God that when they brought us to hospital, that the doctor said that everything is okay.
Yeah.
They wanted to keep me there because Amen. I had headache and they thought maybe I had concussion. But I thank God that on the same day God brought me home
yeah.
safely. And I thank God that he gave me the courage to drive bus again without anything because I know that Jesus will take care of
yeah.
me.
Amen.
I also thank God that last year during our flight, we had turbulence, but I thank God that he brought us all back home safely.
Yeah.
And I promised Jesus that if you bring us back home safely, that I will testify in this camp meeting. And I'm here to testify that God did it. I give all glory to God, and I pray that we all make heaven at last.
Amen.
I want to thank God for the salvation of my soul. I thank God because he's so good to me. I thank God for saving me when I was younger than this. Glory to his name. I just want to thank God for his love and kindness over me. You know, 2014, in December, we were planning to go for the wedding of my niece. And that would be the first grandchild of the family. We were all so excited, you know. So just as we were getting prepared, invitations were out, everything was already in place, my mommy passed away. You know, the devil, my mommy has been looking so much forward to that wedding. She was packed and packed and we were like, oh God, what is she doing? But it was her first grandchild. So her joy was so full. But she died. And it was like, you know, the devil just wants to destroy the joy that is in our heart. But we thank God. You know, God just gave us peace. We went home. We had the wedding. The following week, we had the funeral. It was just, you know, we don't even know what was going on. But God was with us. The children of God supported us all through. And 2 years after, the younger sister to that one wanted to have her wedding. We went again. You know? On the wedding day, I was helping her to prepare the children. And I forgot I left the iron on. And we went to the wedding. The iron was on in Nigeria. And when we came back, they found the iron. They were like, what happened? I don't know what could have happened. You know, the way electricity goes on surge every time in Nigeria. There's nothing that is certain with electricity. But God just protected us. And we came back, we met the iron so hot and boiling. but nothing evil happened to any of us. I just pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we were coming to this camp meeting, the devil was not happy again. We were on the ferry. On the ferry, and the ferry is supposed to travel 9 hours because it was like a cruise ferry. Myself and my husband just went upstairs to the room to, amen. Just thank God for me. God protected him. God has healed him. He fell from the stairs, but God has healed him. I just want to thank God and praise him for you.
I am thanking the Lord this morning because the Lord is good. I was born and raised in this gospel, and I thank the Lord for it. I thank the Lord for the salvation of my soul. The Lord saved my soul when I was very young. He sanctified me and baptized me with the Holy Ghost and fire. In my family, the Bible was an open book where we were taught, you know, what to do and what to do as children. And I thank the Lord that up to today, the Lord can keep. Sometimes, I think it was just still this month, we were away to Portland for camp meeting. And I thank the Lord for journey mercies and the blessings, abundant blessings there. Because camp meeting time is always a refreshing time for me, a blessing time, a re-anointing time when I'm refreshed, I'm, you know, up, filled to the brim. And while we were there, I got the message that my sister was terribly sick. I said, oh God, what could have happened? I prayed. I told my husband, we prayed for her. We phoned her. We discussed with her. Eventually, I said, God, I want this. I want you to make it a miracle that will be one of those things that will hold me up, hold me firm, more firm unto you. And you know what? Behold, while we call her again, she said she was taken to the hospital. We continue to monitor the process. And after a while, she said that she was in the recovery room. I said, what happened? Eventually, she was delivered. And the Lord gave her total victory. In fact, my joy was full, and I thank the Lord for making it a success. My life in all to the Lord.
I bless the name of the Lord. There is power in the blood of Jesus. I thank God for bringing me to this glorious gospel. He called me, he found me, he humbled my heart, and God helped me to surrender. You know, the devil was not happy. My dad is just like Saul of Tarsus. The time I gave my life to Christ, my dad came right inside the church at Elisha Church in Osun State. He got rid of all the ushers there, and he came in with hooligans and thugs and with a lot of beatings, myself and my sister, but he was not able to beat Christ out of my heart. I bless the name of the Lord. Can you believe that same father, he handed me over in marriage in the same church? The same church. This is only what the Lord can do. You know, my dad restituted to the people of God that, oh, please forgive me. It was a time of ignorance. He called the people that has passed away already, Reverend Ogunaike and many others, and he restituted and asked for forgiveness. This is the power of God. You know, my dad, he even took me to our church at Ife. He said, oh, Foluke, you are already running late for your church. Can I drop you off? This is God. This is what the Lord can do. And you know, God, since I gave my life to Christ, God just started working wonders. You cannot believe it. You know, to have 3 consecutive births in this glorious gospel without any medical intervention from conception till delivery, oh, this is only what God can do. This is a unique blessing. This is an uncommon blessing. And I'm glad to tell you that my 3 boys, they are here with me today, and we are all serving God. Please pray for me. I want to serve this God to the end of my life and see face to face. Thank you.
song,
with cheerful songs,
and hymns of praise,
and hymns of praise,
a grateful heart,
a grateful heart,
to him we raise,
to him we raise,
who leads us on,
who leads us on,
with gentle hand,
with gentle hand,
and crowns with love,
and crowns with love,
a Christian band.
Christian band, then gladly let us stand, united heart and hand, the Lord's together in, from sorrow, pain and sin. It is our constant aim, to spread abroad the name of Jesus our Redeemer and His wondrous love proclaim.
And while we meet,
and while we meet
together here,
in bonds of love,
in bonds of love, and friendship dear,
and friendship dear,
oh may our prayer,
oh may our prayers,
like
incense rise
to Him. Whose grace,
to him whose grace,
each need supplies,
each need supplies. Then gladly let us stand, united heart and hand, the lost together in, from sorrow, pain and sin. Be this our constant aim, to spread abroad the name of Jesus our Redeemer and His wondrous love proclaim. Children's friend,
our steps direct,
our steps direct, our paths defend,
and by thine own,
and by thine own,
almighty
hand, almighty hand,
protect and keep,
protect and keep,
our Christian band,
our Christian band. Then gladly let us stand, united heart and hand, the Lord's together in, from sorrow, pain and sin. Be this our constant aim, to spread abroad the name of Jesus our Redeemer and His wondrous love proclaim.
This morning's topic is Christian oneness, also referred to as unity. We'll take our text from Matthew, chapter 22, this is somewhat of a peculiar text to be used for unity, but this is what the Lord laid on my heart, and I couldn't get away from it, despite trying. So, Matthew 22, we see where the Pharisees had come to Jesus and were silenced. If we look at verse 34, it says, "But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, and saying, 'Master, which is the great commandment in the law?' Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love the neighbor, thy neighbor, as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. There are many areas in the Bible where oneness or unity is referenced. We see many times where it is referenced, where it is advised, where Paul references it in his epistles, that it's because of strife or contention in that church. And so he encourages them towards unity. As my wife mentioned in her testimony a few days back, we've been blessed to be able to visit with the saints of God here and there. And we count it a blessing. And there's one thing that I've noticed that is universally true. It doesn't matter where you are. You can be in London. You can be in Africa. You can be in India. You can be in America. It's a universal truth. People want to be treated with love. They want to be treated with kindness. And I wonder how many of the problems that Paul addressed, how many of the problems that were present in the church then, and I believe many that may be present today, could be resolved by following Jesus' advice in these two commandments. Loving our neighbor just like we love ourselves. We want to treat others the way that we want to be treated. I was taught that from a young age. That's probably the first lesson I remember when I would get angry with my siblings. I have two older sisters, and I'd want to get them back for something that they did to me. And my mom or dad would tell me, you need to treat other people the way you want to be treated. And I would say, but what about them? They did this thing to me. Well, I was told that doesn't matter. You need to treat other people the way you want to be treated. I believe if we do that, it will create more unity in our church. Amen. We want to follow Jesus' advice. Yes. Christian oneness or unity can be defined as the state of being united or joined as a whole. Paul gives us a good definition in 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 1, chapter, 1, verse 10. He says, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. That's what we want in our life. That's what we want in our church. We want to have that unity. No division, speaking the same thing, perfectly joined, the same mind, the same judgment. There's a few things that unity is not. It does not have its source in us. Unity does not come from within us on our own. If we look at the book of Psalms, Psalm 133, it says, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard that went down to the skirts of his garments, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. It's like, as the psalmist said, the oil that was poured on and it ran down his beard. The unity didn't come from within him. It was applied onto him.
Right.
We want unity to be in our life, but it doesn't come from within us. It's applied onto us.
Amen.
From the Lord. Because unity does not come from within us, it cannot be gained from where we are, where our location is. We can't rub up to somebody that has unity and have the unity rub off onto us. We can't just simply attend church and expect that because we are in this building, we are therefore unified. We read in Acts chapter 2, that the disciples were all in one accord and in one place. Their location came secondary to the fact that they had one mind. They were in one accord. They were together in spirit. My grandfather, many of you know him, Don Wolfe. I believe he spent a good amount of time here in London. We remember that because we missed him at home. But as many of you may know, and some of you may not, he directed our choir and orchestra in Portland for many years. He was a professional director. He taught at a school called Catlin Gable for many years. And he was very good at what he did. He can play any instrument. If you compare me to him, I can't play any instrument. For whatever reason, my parents, they had my older sisters learn instruments, and when it came to me, I didn't. And so I think I'm probably the only wolf that cannot read music. But I know a little bit about music. I sang in the choir in my youth. I know that when the note goes higher, your voice needs to go higher. And God blessed me with ears that I can hear if I'm singing the same tune, even though I don't know what note that is. I know if I'm singing the same one that the piano is playing. We benefited by the orchestra today and yesterday. And as I said, it takes more than being in one place. The orchestra members can all sit in these chairs and they can hold their instruments. But that's not going to make them unified. They have on these music stands that you can see music. And they have to be on the same page of music. And playing at the same tempo in order to sound coherent, to sound beautiful. When we have unity, it is a beautiful thing. We need music. We need to be on the same music. We need to follow direction. We noticed that when the choir sang, they had a director. He directs the tempo of the music, the speed that they sing. I noticed that last night, the song before prayer, the director, when we got to the very last part of the chorus, he slowed everything down and he held out the last couple of notes. And everybody followed that direction very nicely. And the end result was not what the music had written, but it added a nice little touch to the end. It was very beautiful to see how everybody united, followed that direction, and we could see the result of that. Now, we heard this morning when the orchestra first assembled, they did a warm-up where they're all tuning their instruments. We hear that in sometimes in Portland when there's a concert. There's one violinist, she will play a certain note, and then everybody will tune their instruments off of that so they can hear with their ear if that note that they're playing is the same. Well, nobody comes to a concert to hear everyone tuning their instruments because it doesn't really sound very good. Everybody's just kind of doing their own thing, and there's no unity there. But when they hit that note, when they're all playing the same note, when there's unity, it's pleasing to our ear. That's what music is. It has harmony. It's united. We want to have that in our life.
Amen.
We need to be in one accord. Because unity does not come from within us, we can't take any credit for the good things that happen as a result of it. It's God.
Yeah.
God gives the blessing.
Oh, yes.
As ministers, we like to see people get saved. As a church, we like to see people get saved. But particularly as a minister, we like it when we preach a sermon and we see that everybody responds by coming forward in prayer. That unites us. But we know that it's nothing that we say. In fact, we pray before we preach a sermon, Lord, help me to get out of the way. We don't want our message to be here. We want the message of the Lord to be here. That's what unifies our church, when we can step aside and submit our will to God's will. That's why Paul stated that I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. We give God the glory. In an orchestra or a choir, there's a leader, there's a conductor or a director. If they're not followed, it turns into be a mess. But we want to follow our leader. We want to follow God. We get our instruction from God. We get our instruction from God's word. And so if we are to be united, we must follow God's word. If we are to be united, we must follow the leaders that God puts in place. Just like the choir members have to follow the director or there's a mess, if the orchestra doesn't follow the conductor, there's a mess. It's no longer music, it's just jumbled up notes. If we don't follow God, if we don't follow our leaders, our life will be a mess.
Yes.
Our church will be a mess. It creates division. We don't want discord in our church, we want unity.
Yes.
We want to follow God. The opposite of unity is division. We read in Amos 3:3, can two walk together except they be agreed? We rode to this campgrounds with Brother Stan Nyakua and his wife, Sister Noctula. And because of our number, we had to take two different vehicles. And I rode with Brother Stan, and we were the lead vehicle in that caravan. And we wanted to stop off at a restaurant along the way because the kids were very hungry. And so he put into his navigation the address of that restaurant, and it led us there perfectly. When it was time to come to the camp, he put in the address into his navigation in his phone to take us to the camp. Now, I've never seen this happen before, but somehow the two addresses were both giving directions. Now, one was for the restaurant that was back behind us, and one was for the campgrounds that we wanted to go to. And so it did what navigation does. It gives an audible voice to prompt you, and it would say, go straight, make a U-turn.
Yeah.
Turn left, turn right. Go up to this street and turn right, turn left. And so, not knowing what was going on, he followed the direction for a while, quite a while. And finally, we had come to a stop, and Sister Noctula pulled up next to us and wound down her window. And I believe her exact words were, what are you guys doing? And I explained to her, it's not Stan's fault, it's the navigation. Yes. Something weird happened, and it's giving us two different directions. Well, she said, the road is right here. We've been on the road the whole time. We just got off of it a little bit. To get back on it, it's very simple. Why are you guys spinning in direction? Well, sometimes where we need to go is very simple. It's very direct. We want to go to heaven. The Bible gives us direction on how to go to heaven. We want to follow that direction. But if we're not doing it in unity, it can lead to discord. Two cannot walk together except they be agreed. You can't turn left and turn right at the same time. You can't go straight and make a U-turn at the same time. We want to be in unity. We want to follow God.
Amen.
Division hurts unity. It disrupts it. It hinders it. It can prevent it. We know that we cannot make somebody else in unity any more than I can make you get saved. I can make you choose to follow God. I cannot make you do that. I cannot make you be unified. Unity is something that we pray for in our life. Unity is something that we use a mirror for. We only look at ourselves for unity. We look to ourselves and to God. Unity is asking that God's will and our will be aligned. Not that God's will has changed to our will. No, we say, Lord, we don't want our will, not my will, but thy will be done. When we align ourselves to God and ourselves to God's word, that is when we get unity. Don't worry about your brother. Don't worry about your sister. We pray for them. If we see them going a different direction, we pray for them and we try to draw them back with love. But unity comes, it's a personal thing. We see unity in the secular sense, not Christian unity, but we do see it in the secular sense in many ways. As my youngest daughter stated very eloquently in her testimony, we're from America. I'll just point out that was right after she said how much she loves her mommy and daddy. But we are from America. All U.S. currency has a Latin phrase on it. I don't speak Latin, but I know what this phrase means because I remember as a child asking my dad, what does that mean? And he knew what it meant, and he told me. The phrase is E pluribus unum. Now, the meaning of this phrase is rooted in the concept that out of the original 13 colonies sprang up a unified nation. The meaning is, out of many, one. It is the United States of America. This phrase was adopted by Congress in 1782, making it onto America's Great Seal. Ever since then, when you've seen America's seal, it says in Latin, E pluribus unum, out of many, one. It has 13 letters, that phrase, representing those 13 colonies. It then appeared in 1795 on the $5 gold coin, and it's been on our currency ever since. It was our motto, unofficially, but our motto in America was E pluribus unum, until in the 50s where Congress officially passed that the motto of America would be In God We Trust. We're thankful for that. Amen. We're thankful that here still, many centuries later, we're still the United States. We appreciate the unity at home. Well, here in this church, we're thankful that 112 years later, we're still the Apostolic Faith Church. Yeah. We still have the same unity that those back in 1906 benefited from when the Holy Spirit was poured out. Yeah. We want to continue in that unity. Amen. Even in the secular sense, unity cannot exist where there is division. In America, we have had our problems. In the 1800s, there was a big rift about a topic, if slavery should be legal or not, and it caused a great division in our country. And because of that division, we had what's called the Civil War. Because two cannot walk together except they be agreed. That was in 1861 in April, and it ended 4 years later. But there was a division between the North and the South, and we're thankful how God undertook there and how his will was done. But we see that because of that division, there could no longer be unity. And what was caused by it? A great war. Many lives were lost because of that war. Well, we want to have unity in our church. Yes. We're thankful for the unity that exists here. We know that it's not by anything that we have done except for following God's word and for following God, and we give God the glory. Amen. Because unity does not come from within us, we have to keep self in subjection. We have to keep self in check. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians. We read verse 10, Now I beseech you, therefore, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind, the same judgment. We go down to verse 11, for it hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. Now this I say, that every one of you saith, I am of Paul, and I am of Apollos, and I of Cephas, and I of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? These are called rhetorical questions. A rhetorical question is a question that we know the answer to. It's asked simply to make a statement, to make a point, or to have an effect. We know that Paul was not crucified for us. That was the point that Paul was making. Why are you arguing amongst yourselves? It's Jesus. We need to be united. In order to have unity, we need to keep self in subjection. The folks there in the church in Corinth had a problem with competition. Now, competition is not inherently bad, but this was to the extreme, and it's not a new thing. We saw on the road where the disciples were following Jesus that they had discussion amongst themselves of who was going to be the best, who was the greatest, who was the number one disciple. And that causes a rift between brothers and between sisters, between the family of God. We have to keep self in subjection in order to have unity. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, starting with verse 7, 1 Corinthians 3:7 says, so then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. Amen. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. We want to be co-laborers with God. That means you and I working together, unified in purpose to follow God's will. And that is where unity exists. If we go to 1 Corinthians 12, we see that Paul writes about the diversities of gifts. Verse 4 says, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh in all. We don't take any credit. No. We just want to be part of it. Yeah. Verse 12, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into the Spirit. He uses the physical body as an example. We appreciate when our physical body is in unity. Yes. About 6 months ago, I had a very bad injury to my knee where the meniscus, which is a large piece of cartilage that surrounds your knee bone, the patella, had a tear in it. And it was very painful to walk for some time. And, you know, I could still get around without the complete full use of my knee, but it caused some pain. I couldn't run. I couldn't kneel for very long. I couldn't stand up quickly. Well, we need all the members of the body working in order to feel unity, and we appreciate when that happens. Likewise, in our church, we need all of us working together. We want to be co-laborers. We want to serve God in our called capacity. You know, there's a lot of things that were done. If we even look at this church service, there was a lot of things that were done to make this service possible. These chairs were set out. The hymn books were set out here. Somebody set these altars in place. Somebody hung these curtains. Somebody picked the music. Somebody picked all the different things that are taking place here. Some of them were done behind the scenes. Likewise, Paul uses that example in a body that some members seem insignificant, some seem more predominant, but it takes all of them to make things work. That's how unity works. It seems counterintuitive to think that in order to have unity, we'll all be doing something different. But we're all doing something different as part of a bigger picture, as part of following God's word, and we do all of those things differently with unity together. Unity fits together as part of a bigger picture. Amen. I'm going to read in that same section there of 1 Corinthians 12. If we look at verse 15, this is a large section. I'll try to read it slowly. If the foot shall say, because I am not of the hand, am I not of the body? Is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body? Is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it pleased him. He goes on to illustrate this further, but that is to say that we're all important. Standing here behind the pulpit is one small task in the service of God. We all have to do our part. We all have to do the thing that God calls us to do. We're not all called to be preachers. We're not all called to be musicians. We're not all called to be ushers. But one thing we know is we're all called to do something. God has a plan for each one of us, and we have to submit to that plan, and that's where unity exists. Verse 27, now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. We want to be members of the body. Co-laborers. That's where unity exists. Unity can exist when we embrace our call, God's call on our life. Unity can exist when we embrace God's call on our life. Ephesians chapter 4. We'll look at verses 1 through 6. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, even as ye are called, in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. That is unity. That is where unity exists. We want to be co-laborers. We want to serve God in our called capacity with these things that are mentioned here in verse 2. Lowliness, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another in love. Unity is important. One of the most prolific examples of unity that I've ever heard, it described it perfectly, in my opinion at least, was that of a teaching at Portland Camp Meeting years ago, and the minister used an example of a chain. Now, we've all heard the expression, you're only as strong as your weakest link. Now, many of us have been a part of a team of some kind, be it a sports team, a team at work, a team at church. And so perhaps at times we've thought, well, I know who the weakest link is. And the saying is true, we are only as good as our weakest link. That is to say, in a chain, if there is one link that has some kind of a problem, some kind of a defect, perhaps it's warped or it got damaged in some way, if enough tension is placed on that chain, that link will break. And so in the church, it's true, we're only as valuable as our weakest link. However, if we do have that weak link that we've identified and we pull it out, what do we have? Well, we have a new weakest link somewhere. And we can continue to do that, remove the weakest link. But as he stated in his teaching, when we get to the end, what do we have remaining? We have a chain link, not a chain. And therefore, we can't do anything with that. And so even though we are as strong as our weakest link, it's going to take every single one of us in Christ's church to be unified if we want to see God's will be done. It's going to take every single one of us. We don't want to leave anybody behind. God has a plan for each one of us. We want to work together as co-laborers. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, he says, "If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort in love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind." That's what we want in our church, amen, folks. The same mind, the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Right. We want to make heaven.
Yeah.
We want to make heaven, and we want as many people that we come in contact with in our life on earth to make heaven with us.
Oh, yes.
And if we want that purpose, if we desire that purpose more than anything else, it's going to take unity of our church to get us there. We want unity. We continue, verse 3, "Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each other esteem the other better than themselves." Let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. We want to take God's example. Right. We want to take the example that Christ gave. Not selfish, not conceited. We want to serve with humility, knowing that others are more important than us. That's where unity exists. We want to follow Christ's example in being humble, in submitting to God.
Right.
In Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, excuse me, Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9, we see two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. If we skip ahead to verse 12, "And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken." We find that in life there is strength in unity. We're not in this alone. We have each other and we have the Lord. We want to maintain that strength that derives from unity by submitting our will to God, by praying for our church to be united. We read in Acts chapter 2 what the result is. When we have unity. Acts chapter 2, verse 1 says, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were with one accord and in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as of fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. When we submit our life to God, seeking His will, and He unifies His church, we will find the blessing of God.
Amen.
We will find that He saves people that come to our church needing salvation, that He sanctifies believers, and that His Spirit is poured out upon all those who have been sanctified, because God's word promises it.
Amen.
But it's going to take unity of our church. We want to continue the unity that we've been blessed by, that you and I have benefited by these years. We want to make sure that that unity continues.
Right.
We want it to continue in our church because it's important. I worked at the airport in Portland for a short time after 9/11. I worked for the TSA doing security. And I like to study people. I like to look at people, especially when they don't know that I'm looking at them. I like to watch people interact, and I feel like I can learn a lot about them. And one thing I've noticed by watching people, particularly at the airport, is that when we know that the time is coming short that we've had to visit with somebody, or if somebody's going away for a long time, you see that the words are chosen carefully. One of the most common things that you'll see at the airport when you see two people parting is you'll hear one say to the other, "I love you. I love you too." Because they know that their time is short and they want to make use of the small amount of time that they have left. My oldest daughter celebrated her birthday recently, just before we came to this camp. She turned 9. And I'm reminded every year on her birthday about the time when my grandfather, not Don Wolfe that some of you know and that I spoke about, but my mother's father, Don Morris, was in the hospital. He was dying. And he ran the restaurant at the Portland Camp Meeting for many years, and he was a good man. In the year that Selah was born, when she was born, he was sick in the hospital, he was dying, and we were told there's not going to be much time left. And so we wanted my grandfather to meet Selah. And he had been reasonably well throughout that last few months of his life when Samin was pregnant. He had given Selah a nickname, Bright Star. And it was important to us that he got to meet her before he went on to his reward. And so when she was very young, only a couple weeks old, we took her to the hospital, and my grandpa was in and out, but we have a picture of her laying on the bed with him. And actually the last thing that he purchased on this world was a blanket at the hospital that he bought for her. And it was just either the next day or 2 days later that he passed away. Now, because I knew that my time with him was very short, I had some things that I wanted to talk to him about. You know, I had a lot of good memories with my grandfather. I spent my summers at their house, and I remember many things that he told me, but I know there's many things that I forgot, many things that weren't important at the time. But I will tell you this. I remember every word that was spoken on that day. Because I wanted to tell him how thankful I was for the heritage that I had. How thankful that I was that he came into this gospel. That because of him, my parents were, my mom was raised in the gospel. And that because of that, I had the benefit of being raised in the gospel. I wanted to take an opportunity to thank him for different pieces of advice that he had given me throughout my life. And the words that we spoke that day were very important to me. What we see in the gospel, in John, that Jesus knew his time was very short. He knew that he was going to be betrayed. And I believe that because Christ came as man, the situation was the same. He knew that he had very few words left to share with his followers. No doubt in the Bible there were many words that Jesus spoke that were not recorded. I'm sure he greeted people every morning when he saw them. Probably asked them if they enjoyed their meal, told them good evening, because he loved them. But these words that he used at the final point of his life on earth, I believe he chose them very specifically because he knew that his time was short. And we read in the 20th verse of chapter 17, when he prays for his followers, he says, "Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word." He's praying for us.
Amen.
His final words to them was a prayer for this church, for those that would believe because of the testimony of those that followed him.
Amen.
And then he goes on to say that they all may be one.
Amen.
"As thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me." Jesus' last prayer was for us, that our church would have unity.
Amen.
Why was that? Because he knew it was important.
Yes.
It was so important, he chose his words so carefully to let us know how important it was that we be unified. Folks, we want to have unity in our church. We're thankful for the unity that we've benefited by. We want to make sure that it continues. We want to pray for one another. We're going to have an opportunity to pray now. If we pray for one another, if we pray for God's will in our life, that's what God will bless. We'll see that God comes down in that prayer and meets the need of each heart. We're going to have a time to come forward now and pray.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your word, Lord. Lord, we don't want this word to stand in judgment against us. Lord, your people are standing and kneeling before you, Lord. Come down, Lord. Bless us this morning. We want to be united as a church, Lord. We don't want to be hearers only. We want to be doers, Lord. Lord, meet us at the point of our need this morning. Bless every member of this household. We know that you can do more than we can ask. Lord Jesus, thank you for everything, for we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.